Oh sudah ya Pak? Iya, katanya sudah Mas.
Sudah muncul live-nya?
Oh sudah muncul ya Pak ya?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So, my name is Ahmad Rehan Darmawan. I am the student of Environmental Engineering program here in Brawijaya University, and it's a very precious chance for me to be your master of ceremony on this very special occasion of International Guest Lecture from Konya Technical University. And also, right now, we already have around 90 participants in the Zoom room. Okay. First of all, let us say thanks to God who has given us guidance, happiness, healthiness, and mercy amidst this pandemic, so we can all attend and participate in this special event, hopefully without any obstacles. To the Honorable Speaker, Dr. Hati Sunal Erkan, to the Honorable Dr. Lakofia Hawa as the head of an Agricultural Engineering Department, to the Honorable Dr. Fajri Anugroho as the head of Environmental Engineering Study Programs, and to all my dear participants. Ladies and gentlemen, before we come to this main session, let us start this event by praying first so that the event that we will hold on this day will run well without any obstacle at all. Pray based on individual belief begins. And then, so before we would like to go to this event, let me introduce you to the rundown of this event. For today's event, we will start with opening, and then we go to the speech from Dr. Lakofia Hawa, the chairman of Agricultural Engineering Department. And the next will be a speech from Dr. Fajri Anugroho, the head of Environmental Engineering Study Program. And the fourth will be main lecture from Dr. Hati Sunal Erkan. And the last one will be closing. And for these events, for your information, there shall be several attendance rules that participants have to oblige. The following attendance rules are: number one, the participants must mute their microphone while the event is ongoing unless asked to do otherwise. Participants must also behave in the comment sections of both Zoom room and the YouTube live streaming so to not cause any troubles. And the second, the participants that wanted to ask questions to the speaker that has already joined the Zoom room shall post the questions and give mark in the chat pool. And to all the participants that otherwise joined this guest lecture from the live streaming YouTube shall post their questions in the comment sections of this YouTube live streaming channel. So let's begin. As the first agenda of the day, let us hear the speech from Dr. Lahofia Hawa as the chairman of Agricultural Engineering Department. Ladies and gentlemen, here is the speech from Dr. Lahofia Hawa. Mr. Aulia, please.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. The Honorable All Staff Member of Agricultural Engineering Department, the Honorable Assistant Professor Dr. Hafiz Kemal Erkang from Konya Technical University, Turkey, the Honorable Ladies and Gentlemen. First of all, I would like to say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alamin, thanks to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, because of His blessing and mercy, today we can gather in a healthy and good condition. Guest lecture is an annual event to enhance the staff and also the student competence. And from this event, we can get the main theoretical and also practical knowledge information from another country.
What's up,
and today, we are proud to present the international guest lecture from Associate Professor Dr. Hafiz Kemal Erkang from Konya Technical University with a theme Geochemistry Approach for Environmental Deposition Assessment. In this occasion, I would like to say thank you very much for
Ada yang bocor?
I'm looking forward to seeing positive outcome from this event, and I hope all of you will gain the utmost benefit.
Ah, ini.
For the audience mute. And also
mute.
Please do not hesitate to ask
pemateri,
the question to Dr. Hafiz Kemal Erkang. Thank you very much for your great attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you. And that's the speech from Dr. Lahofia Hawa. And for the next agenda, will be a speech delivered by Dr. Fadri, the head of Environmental Engineering Study Program. For Dr. Fadri, time and place is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone in Indonesia. Good morning, yeah, everyone also in Turkey. Yeah, welcome to today's webinar, international guest lecture, hosted by the Environmental Engineering Program, University of Brawijaya. I would like to say thank you very much to Dr. Hafiz Erkang from Konya Technical University. Yeah. That deliver lecture today. As information, we have now 168 participants from Turkey and Indonesia today, mostly from Indonesians, some from Turkey. Yeah, mostly also from academic, and some from professional. Now our study program, Environmental Engineering in Faculty of Agricultural Technology, University of Brawijaya, located in Malang, is Java province, yeah, in Indonesia, is ongoing process to international accreditation in this year. So I hope that this event, yeah, can benefit, yeah. We can get benefit from this event to international accreditation. So we should conduct international collaboration also to any overseas university in the world. And I hope that all participants enjoy this event. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Fadri, for the speech. So for the next agenda, well, we will have a photo sessions first. And all of the participants that has already joined the Zoom sessions, I would like to ask for all of you to please turn on the video camera as we are taking pictures together for all the participants. So for all participants, I would like to ask that each and every one of you should turn on their video camera for us to take a picture as the documentations. And let's take a picture in 3, 2, 1 and T's. Committee, is it enough?
Sudah di print screen.
Okay, one more.
Once more, Raihan.
Okay. Okay, let's take a picture again once more in 3, 2, 1 and T's. Okay, that, I think that's going to be enough for the photo sessions. So before we would like to come down to the main guest lecture sessions, I would like to first introduce our today's moderator. So for today's guest lecture, will be moderated by Dr. Ahmad Adi Sudistian. So Dr. Adi is a lecturer of Environmental Engineering Program here in Brawijaya University, and also the head of the Waste Treatment Laboratory, Faculty of Agriculture Technology, Brawijaya University. So Dr. Adi has finished his undergraduate program here in Agricultural Engineering, Brawijaya University, and also continue his postgraduate and doctoral studies in Miyazaki University, Japan. So without further ado, for the next agenda, I would like to bid a very warm welcome to my own lecturer, Dr. Adi, that will moderate these guest lecture sessions with Dr. Hatis Unal Erkan. To Dr. Adi, time and place is yours.
Thank you very much, Rehan. Ladies and gentlemen, before we start the lecture from Dr. Hatis, I think I should introduce about her. The full name of our today's speaker is Hatis Unal Erkan, and now she is the lecturer in Konya Technical University, Department of Chemical and Chemical Processing Technologies. She conducted undergraduate program in Selçuk University, Department of Geological Engineering, and she continued to the master and PhD program in Istanbul Technical University. Now he is a lecturer in Konya Technical University in the Department of Chemical and Chemical Processing Technologies. She has experience to be a visiting researcher in the Department of Geology in the University of Georgia, Athens in United States, America, and she has some research interests such as mineralogy, field geology, hydrothermal alteration, geochemistry, clay mineralogy, XRD, SEM, geochemistry of the stable isotope, interpretation of the geological deposition environment. And today, our topic is about the geochemistry deposition and environmental. Thank you very much for our speaker today, and I think you can handle the presentation by yourself, and I think it's enough for the introduction, and now time is yours, Dr. Hatis, please.
Uh,
Hi everyone, good morning or good afternoon. My name is Hatice Ünal Erdem. Welcome to my presentation. First of all, I would like to thank the department chair of the RJ Cultural Engineering, Rocheva Hava, the head of the engineering study program, Paju Anukro, moderator Ali Suranti, and all communities who contributed this event for giving me such a opportunities. And a special thanks for the Lujina for her supporting. And I am a geological engineer and I am working as a lecturer in the chemistry and chemical processing technologies at the Konya Technical University. My studies are about the interpretation of geochemical environments with stable enzymes, isotopes and geochemical data. And I will give briefly information in my presentation about the stable isotope and a case study from Turkey. Hi everyone. I will tell you about the geochemistry approach for the environmental deposition assessment. And I said before, my name is Hatice and I am a lecturer in the Konya Technical University and chemistry and chemical processing the technologies department. Today I will talk about the stable isotopes and firstly I will definition of the stable isotopes. Then I will talk about the behavior of the hydrogen and oxygen stable isotopes in the water cycle. After that, I will explain some isotopes used in the definition and interpretation of the evaporation environment. Finally, application of stable isotope in evaporation environment, a case study from Turkey. I would like to give a brief information about the isotopes for the beginners. X is a chemical symbol for the any element, and the superscript A denotes the mass number, sum of the number of the protons and neutrons. Subsecret Z that denotes the atomic number and symbol of the neutron numbers. Isotopes are atoms that have the same number of protons, but have different number of neutrons. Having a different number of neutrons gives the atom different mass. Isotopes can divide into two fundamental kinds, stable and unstable, of course, radioactive species. Measuring and analyzing their distribution allows for many practical applications, such as interpretation of problems, environmental process, climate change process, or origin process. I will try to explain stable isotopes throughout the carbon elements. Carbon isotopes come into three forms. The most common isotopes isotope of carbon is carbon 12, which contains 6 neutrons and 6 protons. The next heaviest isotopes, carbon 13, has 7 neutrons and 6 protons. Both of these are called stable isotopes because they don't decay into other forms or elements over the time. The rare carbon 14 isotopes contain 8 neutrons in the nucleus. Unlike the others, this isotope unstable or radioactive. The vast majority of the all carbon on Earth is carbon 12. Almost 99% of carbon on Earth is often this form, while only approximately 1% of all carbon on the Earth is of the carbon 13 isotopic form. Carbon 14 is still much rarer. Only one out of every trillion carbon atoms is carbon 14. I will talk about the isotope effects. Differences in chemical and physical properties arising from the variation in atomic mass and element called isotope effect. Electronic structure of elements element essentially determines its chemical behavior, whereas the nucleus is responsible for its physical properties. The best example for this is a water molecule. Some differences in physicochemical properties of light and heavy water molecules. This example, all those formulas of the same water molecules is the same, changes occur on some parameter like this density, melting point, boiling point, due to differences in stable isotope ratio. The reason for this depth is the vibration frequency of light isotopes. What is the vibration frequency and what is its importance? The vibration frequency of molecule varies according to presence of heavy isotopes and light isotopes. The more orderly and closely packed structure tend to accumulate heavier isotopes. This means that the bonds formed by the light isotopes are weaker than the bonds involving the heavy isotopes. Thus, during the chemical reaction, molecules bearing the light isotopes will, in general, react slightly more readily than with heavy isotopes. That is simply light isotopes have a high vibration frequency, and when the water evaporated, the remaining water enriched with heavy isotopes, and the water vapor enriched with light isotopes. I will explain it in next slide. Isotope fractionation. Simply, isotope fractionation is defined as a relative partition of the heavier and lighter isotopes between two coexisting phases in natural system. Fractionation factor for isotopes extends reaction in geochemistry. The equilibrium constant K often replaced by fractionation factor alpha. The fractionation factor is defined as a ratio number of any two isotopes in geochemical compound A divided by corresponding ratio another chemical compound of B. If the isotopes are randomly distributed over all possible positions in the compound A and B, then alpha is related to equilibrium constant calculated like this. Isotope fractionation can be explained simply this reaction. In this reaction, the light oxygen isotopes prefer the liquid phase. The heavy isotopes, oxygen isotopes, arranged in the crystal structure of calcium carbonate. The light oxygen isotopes in the calcite calcium carbonate crystal break up from the solid phase and switched from the liquid phase due to high vibration frequency of light isotopes. Heavy isotopes remain in the crystal structure of calcite and enriched. Equilibrium constant can be expressed as a ratio of heavy and light oxygen isotopes in carbonate phase to the dead heat in the water. This leads to concept of isotope fractionation factor alpha that represents the partition of isotopes between two different phases. Fractionation factor is defined as a ratio of isotopes in one phase to other coexisting phases. In the calcium carbonate to water system, fractionation factor calculated like this. But what is the meaning of these values? If the ratio is greater than the one, it means that the react with the lighter isotopes more readily, and it is termed normal. It is called inverse when the ratio is less than one, and one indicated that the react with heavier isotopes react more readily, rapidly. Isotope fractionation epsilon is defined for this formula, and in this example, when we calculate the 25 centigrade degree of calcite and water fractionation factor, we find the 31 formula. And in the other example, when we calculate the 33.7 centigrade degree of the calcic water fractionation factor, we find the 28 formula. It indicates that the isotopic fractionation decreases with the increasing temperature. Finally, delta notation. In isotope geochemistry, it is common practice to express isotopic composition in terms of delta notation. All the stable isotopes are measured in terms of the proportion of the between less and more abundant isotopes, and it is referred to non-standard throughout the data notation. R is calculated calculated rare isotopes divided by abundant isotopes. Data notation calculated like this: R sample divided by R standard and minus one. But it is multiplied by 100 for this to get more understandable values. To compare isotope data from different laboratories, an international accepted set of standards is necessary. The accepted unit of the isotope ratio measurement is delta value, and it's given in Fermi. I said standards, and these are the widely used standards worldwide, and these are the elements, and these are the used elements standards. You know, and if you send a sample to tomorrow by isotopic analysis, you should know that your sample will be analyzed first on mass spectrometry. The results sent to you are the delta notation that is obtained by divided by the sample with the standard, national standard. If your result of the isotopic analysis higher than the standard, it indicates the enrichment of your sample isotopic value. If it's poor, it indicates depleting of your sample isotopes values.
Kok tampilnya di YouTube beda ya?
What can isotopes tell us at the global water cycle? And tampilnya you know water consists of the hydrogen and oxygen atoms. Therefore, I will give you a brief information about these isotopes. Until then, it was assumed that hydrogen contains only one isotope. Oh. This is protonium. It has only one proton. After 1933, the detected presence of second stable isotope, which is called the deuterium. It has a one proton and neutron. In addition to these two stable isotopes, there is a third national occurring but radioactive isotope. This is pteridium. It has a two neutron and one proton. This range of the hydrogen isotope composition of the some geological imported reservoirs are given is in this figure. We said that the ocean water is considered zero, which is mostly used for standard. The region for the spread of meteoric waters to a wind range is related to water cycle. All rocks on the Earth have similar hydrogen composition. The reason for this overlap in the isotope composition for rocks is likely due to enormous amount of the water that have been cycled throughout the outer crust of the Earth. These are the hydrogen isotope standard. This standard shaped according to your studies. And this is the Vienna standard mean ocean water represents zero, and Greenland ice sheet precipitation and Vienna standard light article precipitation are very low values. I will give information about these lower values next slides. Another most abundant element is the Earth is oxygen. It is occur in gas, liquid and solid compounds, most of which are thermally stable over the large temperature range. This fact make oxygen one of the most interesting elements in isotopic geochemistry. Oxygen has a three stable isotopes. These are 16, 17, and 18. The abundance of oxygen is here, and there are two different standards using for the oxygen stable isotope. One of them Vienna PD Belemnitz, and other one is Vienna standard mean ocean water. And heavy oxygen waters accepted the again zero. And again, the region for the spread of meteoric water a bit range is related to water cycle. Now, I will tell again, what can isotope tell us the global water cycle. Now I will give brief talk about the isotope fractionation in the water cycle. Since a water molecule containing deuterium or heavy oxygen molecules, heavier than the normal oxygen molecule, when the ocean water vapor evaporated, size of water molecule containing deuterium and heavy oxygen molecules is heavier than a normal light water molecule. When the ocean water is evaporated, water vapor will be depleted heavy isotopes relative to ocean water. Condensation forming raindrops from the cloud reverse this process because these heavier molecules condense and disperse, and rain isotopically enriched. The cloud moisture is subsequently depleted as the rain cloud continues. Precipitation in polar region is isotopically lighter than the low altitude. Groundwater originating from the infiltration at the high altitude are lighter than the lowlands. Surface water preferentially lose their lighter waters due to evaporation. They are often enriched heavy isotopes. Heavy isotopes which they are were formed. In this figure, you can see ocean water, oxygen, and hydrogen isotopic values are zero thermal. It's here, and we see that heavy isotope is depleted in water vapor. Both isotopes have a negative minus values. In the condensation of the process that creates raindrops from the cloud, while the raindrops are enriched with heavy isotopes, the vapor part becomes even more enriched in the light isotopes. The water vapor atmosphere becomes enriched for the light isotopes as it goes to high latitude, altitude, and every time it rains. And this binary diagrams show the correlation between oxygen and deuterium isotopes values in meteoric water, and deuterium values equal 8 multiplied by heavy isotopes, sum of the 10. Since I will tell about the halite minerals in the following slides, I will give you a brief information about how to precipitate halite minerals and other evaporite minerals. Evaporation happens when a liquid substance became gas. When water heated, it evaporated. The molecules move and vibrate so quickly that they escape into atmosphere as a molecule of water vapor. See, water contains a large range ion solution is here. Positive ions such as calcium, sodium, and potassium. Negative ions are chloride, carbonate, and sulfide ions. Seawater is slightly supersaturated with respect to calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate precipitates first and deposits a layer of the calcit or argonit form at the bottom of the jar. Don't forget that other ions are still concentrated in the liquid phase. With further evaporation, that therefore an increasing salinity, the solution became supersaturated. With respect to another salt, gypsum, the solution is called porcelain, and gypsum precipitate on the calcite, calcium carbonate mineral. Then with the further increasing the evaporation and increasing salinity, the next precipitation step in the sodium chloride, namely salt or halite minerals. Now solution is called saline. The last pass before completed evaporation concerns potassium chloride salt, commonly potassium salt. The solution is hypersaline. And I will give you information about the chlorine, bromine, lithium, and boron isotopes because I use it in my doctorate thesis, and I tell this chlorine about and others isotopes in the other slides. Chlorine has two stable isotopes. Is light one is the chlorine 45, and heavier is the chlorine 37. The abundance percent varies respectively between 75 and 24%. Delta values are generally given relative to seawater chlorine term, standard mean ocean chlorine is here and is considered zero. Chlorine is silicate, appears to be arranged compared to coexisting brine. In the process where the chlorine isotope reaction is effective, the solution of light chlorine isotopes from the saline water in the brush water is faster than the heavy chlorine isotopes. This explains why the heavy chlorine isotopes is arranged in the halite. Positive heavy chlorine values indicate the first stage of evaporation, while low chlorine values indicate the final stage of evaporation because light chlorine isotope prefer the liquid phase. Bromine is the another important isotopes for the evaporation environment. Bromine has the two stable isotopes with nearly equal abundance. First of the light isotope is 79, and other one is heavier, bromine 81. And bromine concentration is the most biological setting are too low for a presence isotopic measurement. A notable exception are sedimentary formation water, because bromine is more sensitive to oxidation than the chlorine. Bromine transforms in the bromine due to its high oxidation probably and mixing the atmosphere. Additionally, during the evaporation process, bromine concentrated in the seawater and precipitate with potassium and magnesium salt. Bromine isotopes can be measured easily directly from the halite minerals. And delta values are generally given relative to seawater and acceptances again zero. Another important isotopes is the boron. Boron has two stable isotopes and a light one is the boron 10 and heavier one the boron 11. The abundance percent varies between 20 and 80%. The most characteristic feature of the boron isotope is isotopic composition of argon water. With constant nearly approximately 40 per mil. Depletion of the heavy bromine occurred in the continental crude and fresh and other marine sediments. In the upper mantle, a low depletion occurred in the heavy bromine isotopes. While the lowest bromine value was observed in the coast, minus 7 per mil, it's related to microbial activity. The biggest enrichment was determined in deep sea Israel. It's related to heavy evaporation factors. In the geological time, boron isotope composition of the seawater showed significant differences. The region for this seawater heavy boron isotope values changes due to continental erosion and ocean-rich activities. Today, factors such as climate change and environmental pollutions are observed and to significant change to pH of the ocean water. In seawater, boron isotopes is found two different molecule structure as a boric acid and borate. Heavy boron isotopes prefer the boric acid during the evaporation and boric acid remains in the seawater so that seawater is enriched by the heavy boron isotopes. And boric acid is dominant in the present day seawater. But as pH is increased, borate is increased in the seawaters. Percentage of clay in the sample causes the boron isotopes values to be lower than the expected because clays can absorb nearly 20 parts per mil isotopic values. The last one, the isotopes, is important isotopes is the lithium. Lithium has a two stable isotope. Light one is the lithium 6 and heavier is the lithium 7. The abundance percentage is here and lithium is one of the rare elements where the light isotope is less abundant than the heavier one. Like the boron isotope, the other slide, the boron isotope the same character, but other isotopes is lighter isotopes richer than the Earth. Lithium isotope is characteristic by the difference close to 31 per mil between the ocean water. And now I am going to tell you about my doctoral thesis. We studied the origin and formation environment of Salt Lake. The name of this lake is the Tuzbili in the Turkey. It is my doctoral thesis. This study is supported by the Scientific and Technological Research Council of the Turkey. My doctoral thesis supervisor is Professor Dr. Muazzez Çelik Karakaya. Also, she is my project manager. Outline my studies. First of all, I will talk about the geological and structural geology of study area. Then I will definition of mineralogical properties of halite. After that, geochemical properties of halite, and then our main subject isotopic properties of halite, and finally conclusion macrophages and coagulation. Geological and structural geology of study area. The blue area is the salt lake of Tuz Gölü, and the red dashed area are borders of the Konya Cloud Basin. It is it's the Turkey, and here Mediterranean Sea, here Aegean Sea and Black Sea. This is our study area. Salt Lake is located in Konya Cloud Basin in the middle of the Turkey. The basin is bounded by Aegean, Aksum Province in the west, and Arabian Anatolian continental collision zone in the east. The basin rock unconformally overlain by Upper Cretaceous Quaternary sediments with a measurable peak 5,000 to 10,000 meter from the west to east. The formation of Tuz Gölü Basin, which was controlled by bordered faults, Tuz Gölü Fault Zone, Sultanahmet Fault Zone, Cihanbeyli Fault Zone and Niğde Fault Zone, started during the late Cretaceous. These fault zones, the basement units are unconformably overlain by the late Cretaceous Quaternary thick, deep and shallow marine carbonate, evaporite clasting and volcanic rocks. We used 3 drilling in our studies. These are drilling named TG3, 4 and 6. Stratigraphic column of the TG3, TG4 and TG6 drilling located in the southern part of the Tuz Gölü Basin. Pale brown area represents the layer containing poor halite. And the detailed geological map our drilling location is here. The thickness of the poor halite layer varies from the millimeter to meters. Halite-rich layers were observed between 500 to 540 meters for the TG3, between 600 to 800 meters for the TG4, and between the 350 and 770 meter for the TG6. Firstly, I will talk about the macroscopic and microscopic properties of halites in this section. This is the stratigraphic column of the TG7 drillings, and these are the textures. The clearest lithological feature of the drilling sample is repeating of the layers with the different mineralogical composition. The ordered and disordered rhythmic mineral sequence is repeated at the millimeter, meter or centimeter scale, a pattern which is similar to Sapka cycle. The most common evaporite mineral is basin, halite, globarite, anhydrite, gypsum and carbonate minerals. Carbonates are dolomite and magnesite. We were not only determining the mineralogical composition of the Tuz Gölü, but also their texture. This texture gives us information about the weather minerals determined in course are primary precipitation minerals or secondary precipitation minerals. It is very important for us because we use only primary minerals for isotopic analysis. These are secondary mosaic halite and primary competitive growth perpendicular halite minerals and slab structure secondary. And these are the secondary enterotic structure and nodular structure. These these are the again macroscopic photo of the core samples of tutkulu basin. The primary and secondary texture were determined from the pyrrhalite, and primary texture of halite hopper crystal, vertically oriented halite crystals and chevrons, and coloring strength I will tell you. And secondary texture of the halite are clear bedded halites like this, and mosaic structure and S-shaped halites. These are the macroscopic properties, and ephedral globulite minerals. Other two pictures represent the two direction cleavage of the halite matrix.
Next slide. Next.
Subhedral anhedrite minerals and halite matrix. Two direction cleavage of the halite crystal and hood-like structure. These are very important structure of for us the primary chevron halite, and these are the flute inclusion. Dark lines indicate the rich flute inclusion.
Next.
I said primary structure is very important for us because we used our flute inclusion analysis, flute inclusion, primary structures, flute inclusion. And these are the hopper crystals from the thin section. Halite hoppers form halite crystals, primarily develop under stable environment conditions where there are no wind or no wind meteors. Hoppers start to grow surface when the solution becomes oversaturation with sodium chloride. Hopper crystal continue to grow as a rock to form cumulates and then float until the crystal mass exceeds the surface tension and finally sink to is halite chevron crystals. The chevron structure are interpreted as originating at the bottom of the shallow barium, where the upward elevation show the rapid and such as 0 or 1 meters. These are the SEM image of the halites. This ephedral halite crystal and dissolution surface. This anhedral halite crystal, globulite minerals and halite matrix. And needle-like globulite and dissolution surface of the halite. This is hopper crystal and secondary S-shaped halite is here. In this study, we used geochemical data as well as the isotopic data for detecting the origin of tuzgulu basin. I am going to tell you about the geochemical investigation now. Distribution of bromine and potassium element valence sample from the TG3, TG4 and TG6 drillings. Especially bromine and potassium content give important information about the origin and formation environment of halite. Bromine is an important element used in determining marine origin. Bromine content is high in the samples of TG4, like this, and but medium or low in the sample of the TG3 and 6. The content of bromine is, I said before, quite widely used for the determining origin of basin. Halite formed from the evaporation of Mediterranean seawater containing 40 ppm. Of the bromine suggests that the bromine resistance time approximately 100 million age. That indicates bromine concentration of halite formed from the evaporation of Tunisic seawater must be high as 40 ppm. The brom content of the pool halides in the Tuzgölü basin is generally higher than the 40 ppm for TG4, but lower than the 40 ppm for TG3 and TG6. The reason for the high brom content of the TG4 drilling can be explained by initial halide precipitation from Nielsen seawater, but low brom concentration may be resulted from recycled marine halides. The potassium content of the synthetic water halide in constant and given 40-140 ppm. And potassium content of the Tuzgölü sample varying from here, varying from nearly 50 and 420 ppm. Potassium content is lower than the other Cenozoic seawater. The region of the low potassium content in pool halide sample in the basin is related to the existence of clay minerals, because clay minerals absorb the potassium mineral. This is a logarithmic plot of the concentration trend of chlorine versus bromine during the evaporation of seawater, show the initial precipitation point of evaporate minerals. And this figure shows the some of the possible mixing scenarios with different halting products and different. And figure all the Tuzgölü samples show the high chlorine content and low and intermediate bromine content, indicating that the ancient marine halides was dissolved by intruding saline water such as sea waters or sodium chlorine rich water in the basin.